You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we learn all about the Translator API and cognitive services. It's pretty amazing. Make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. We're going to talk about Translator API and cognitive services. I got a special guest, my friend. Hello, tell us who you are and what you do.
Hey, Seth. Hello. Nice talking with you. My name is Chris Wendt, and I'm the Group Program Manager for Microsoft's Translation Service.
All right. So let's dive in. What is the Translation Service? Why is it important? How to use it? Let's get into it.
All right. I'd love to talk about it. The Translation Service translates. It translates between natural language. And it translates speech and it translates text. Text is really a pretty simple thing. You give it a piece of text, it returns to you the translation of that piece of text. A speech is a little more complicated, and I want to introduce you to both today. We are, of course, motivated by breaking down the language barrier between people. We want people to communicate, people to talk to each other, but in fact, not just people talking to each other. It's also machines interpreting what people are writing in order for processing it, or just to render it for another human or for some AI that you want to run on it. Say, for instance, to extract information out of a translated document. So breaking down language barriers is what we do. That's in our DNA. And what's important for you to know is that automating translation is really cheap. It's about a factor of 1,000 cheaper than human translation, so you can do a lot more with it. It is infinitely faster. It is, however, not as good.
Right?
You don't get as good a translation out of it. There's a difference between languages. So the most translated languages of the world, generally, I say the 20 most translated languages of the world. That includes French, German, Italian, Spanish, Chinese, Japanese, Portuguese, and a bunch more. They translate really well. As you move out of those most translated languages, there's just less training material available. So the vocabulary coverage and the fluency just goes down a little bit for the languages that are not in the top 10. So here I have calculated what it costs. So to translate a million words, you pay about $250,000 to have that translated in human translation quality with the machine, and that's our most expensive service. That's the customized machine translation functionality that costs you $280 to translate the same amount.
That's for the most expensive one too?
That's the most expensive. The cheapest one would cost you $70.
Holy cow.
Yeah, that is quite a difference. And so you get a much cheaper price, you get infinitely faster, but you pay for it in quality. So, but how bad really is the quality? So, quick history: machine translation is old. It was invented in the 1950s, and it has made steady advances since then. So every 5 to 10 years, you have a major algorithmic improvement. The latest one was really the neural networks, and specifically the transformer models inside the neural networks have brought us the latest noticeable increase in quality. Between these 5 to 10 years, we can improve the automatic translation quality by adding new or better filtered training material, and you can do the same. Like, you can adjust the or improve the translation quality for your terminology and domain by using a feature that we have. It's called Custom Translator, that allows you to upload previously translated documents. You don't need that many, of them. About 10,000 sentences is the minimum. 20,000 will create a noticeable difference. Anything above that is helpful. Is goodness, and then you build a system that knows your terminology and style much better than our generic system.
This is really cool because I don't know, most people don't know this, and maybe you know this, but I basically did research in machine translation. That's what I went to school for, and I studied the IBM models 1 through 5, and I went to school right before neural networks became popular again. And so it's really cool to see this history, and it's really cool to see a semi-supervised approach too, where you give it some information and it gets a little bit better from there.
Yes, exactly. And so the goal is to reach human parity, right? Be as good as a human. In 2018, we said we have reached it in the Chinese to English news domain by just comparing it to a human translator and then have a judge go judge it sentence by sentence. So in that news domain, it worked okay because fairly clean language that is published in news. Where you translate more difficult stuff like what we are talking now, that's not perfectly clean, or when you have chat messages or so, that's not perfectly clean, as it's not necessarily grammatically correct and with the right casing and punctuation, it falls off. The human still does better. So I want to talk now a little bit about how you actually use it in your application. So translation of text is a very simple process. So there's one function, it's called translate. Well, that's not one function. It's the most important function,
right?
Above everything else. And it's a stateless REST API. You give it a piece of text in a JSON package. You get back that same text in the other language in a JSON package. That's pretty much it. The input formats are plain text or HTML. You can translate more than 70 languages, any to any. You don't have to specify the source language. You can just let the system guess what the source language was, but you need to specify one or more target languages. You can translate to multiple languages at once in the same request, and then you get just different rows in your JSON array.
You get it back. You don't have to tell it the input language? You just tell it the output languages?
Yeah, you have the option to tell it. If you are sure what it is, then you can specify it so there are no detection mistakes. The text detection works quite safely, right? So it's unlikely to make mistakes except for very closely related languages. So, for instance, between Russian and Ukrainian, it may pick one or the other, because they have very similar character sequences.
Of course.
In them, yes, and that's how it works. Or Danish and Swedish, they are also somewhat confusable, but generally it works very very safely, even for short strings.
Cool.
The next function here on this list is the languages function. It's just an enumeration, tells you which languages you can translate between. It also gives you the friendly name of the language, so you can render it in your UI to have the user choose in whatever language we translate. We also give you the language name so that you can allow user to choose from it, plus all the other things you can do with a particular language. So not all languages, for instance, have a transliteration, which is the next function here. So transliteration is to change the script of a piece of text, say between a native script and the romanized script. For instance, if you have Arabic or Chinese, there's a Latin script version of it. That makes it readable for people who don't really read the language, but who don't read the characters of the language, but still want to understand it or learn it or so. So it's really good for language learning scenarios. Detection just tells you what the language was of a piece of text, just in case you want to base your further processing on it without invoking the translation function. And then break sentences tells you the boundaries of sentences in your text. This is important when you want to translate a long stretch of text, say a longer document, longer than the request size limit, which is 5,000 characters. So then you need to find the last sentence break, because you cannot translate partial sentences. I mean, you can translate them, but it'll produce a bad translation. So you always need to keep sentences intact, and the break sentence method helps you with that. That's already it, Seth. There's not much more to it. Very, very simple API. Very, very simple functionality. I want to mention that. So I talked a lot about translating longer documents or longer strings. We have some sample code on our GitHub repo that helps you do that. We're also working on a document translation API where you can submit a whole document intact, and you don't have to break it by hand. I think that'll be useful.
This is super impressive, because you say that's it. It's just basically a function to translate a language. And I worked on noisy channel models from the IBM series of things in the 90s that I was doing research with in the early 2000s, late 2000s. So this is just not just a function. This is like pure AI magic. Do you have some code you can show us?
Yes, I want to move on to speech, which is actually a little more magical. Than the translation of text. It's more magical because it really combines two very interesting services: the speech recognition and the translation. There's a lot of shared technology below that, below the surface, because they do similar thing, right? They take in a stream of say audio or a stream of text, and then give you a return to you some kind of markup, either the translation or the text of the recognition. And they're both not 100% reliable. They both make mistakes. So if you combine these two, you have a chance to multiply the mistakes. So it took us, and pretty much the world, it took us a while to be brave enough to put these two together. But now both technologies, the speech recognition and the translation, have reached a level where you can really do that, combine those two. So I have listed here the steps of what's necessary in order to do to embark on translating speech, and for this we offer a nice client-side SDK for translation of text. You don't really need that; you can just—it's so simple. But for speech, it's processed using a streaming protocol, and that's fairly hard to manage by hand. So we give you an SDK that's available for all the major operating system and all the programming language, all the major programming languages, so it fits. It's meant to fit your need. So let me just go to the example here. This is the simplest example that you can come up with. This is the whole thing. Let me zoom in a little bit so that you can see it in pieces. You see here at the top, you just include the speech SDK. Then you state what your source and your target language is. Speech also allows you to do language detection. It can detect only between a small set of languages. Translation of text is much easier. Detection of the speech language is much harder than the detection of a text language. So in this example here, we specify it because I speak only two languages, so it's not really that hard. I can say I can speak either English or German, and that's it. And here I chose to translate it to German. Then you simply wait for the recognizer to give you a result, and then you do something with it. If there's success, in this case, this app here just prints out the recognition and the translation. And what this doesn't show is that you get the partial results while I'm talking. So you can do real-time actions before the end of the utterance. And I have an example here. If I may show that, that's okay. That's great that I can show that. That is on GitHub in the Azure Speech SDK repo that shows how that all works nicely together. So it's a fairly ugly UI, as it's supposed to be for a demo app. I choose here which language I'm speaking. So I'm speaking English here. I want to translate it to Chinese and to German. Just same thing here. You can translate to multiple languages at once. And as part of the API, you get for free the audio of one of these Holy languages. Cow. So I can choose that here as well. We wanted to do it that way to enable, say, real time conversations between people, right? So that I can speak something, and then my app can make myself be heard in the other language. And this way you can build a bidirectional conversation. Okay, let me show you how that works. Hello, how are you doing today? If you listen carefully, you heard the Chinese is coming out of my system speaker here. Let's do it again. Now I'm saying something that's a little longer, so that you can see the partial results as I'm speaking. You can see the results of my recognition as I am speaking. Okay, so you not only get the final after I'm done, but you also get the interim in all the languages that are involved here, which is the original and two translations, and one of them is
all. That's really cool. And I also heard the Chinese through your system audio. That was really cool.
Yeah. Good. So let me go to the next one here. You asked what are the other cool things that are coming up. Imagine it's not just the two of us talking to each other, but there's a whole group of people, and they all want to listen to each other. However, they don't share the same language. Right. So on our journey to break down the language barriers, we are building a system that really represents the conversation in the cloud, and each audio channel feeds into that conversation in the cloud, and the cloud distributes the transcript and translation to everybody who is participating. That's really the idea behind it. And it's also consumable via the Speech SDK. It's currently in private preview, and we'd like to invite you to participate in it and try it out, and let us know what you'd like to see in this functionality.
This is all pretty amazing stuff. Where can people go to find out more?
People can visit us on the web, microsoft.com/translator. You see our GitHub repo as well here under Microsoft Translator. You can submit questions on Stack Overflow. We monitor that. Or you can tweet us.
Well, my friend, this has all been pretty amazing. Thank you so much for spending some time with us. And for those of you watching, thank you so much for coming. You've been learning all about what's new in Cognitive Services Translator API, and we got a whirlwind tour of some of the amazing things you can build today. We'll see you next time. Take care, my friends.